Will you be vaccinated?
I am first in line at the MUHC when we are able to be vaccinated. Those of us that are in the field, that live, eat, drink, and breathe the data and the science every single day of our lives, are rushing to get the vaccine.
Vaccination is officially underway now in Quebec and in other parts of the world. And with that now has come all kinds of questions, concerns, but also some myths about the vaccines in the short term and in the long term. People are saying that it's, you know, it's been fast tracked. It's out there too soon. I don't want to be the first one. We don't know the long term side effects. I guess we don't know the long term side effects, right?
So it's absolutely true that we don't know the 20-year side effects of a vaccine that was invented this year. But you know what? We don't know the 20-year side effects of all vaccines when they are licensed, because we don't wait 20 years after a new vaccine has been licensed before we allow it to be used. Nor do we wait for the 20-year side effects of every single drug in the marketplace that everybody is taking for every single disease they have. We also don't know what the 20-year risks of natural infection with COVID-19 are. We're already hearing stories about long COVID in young people. The other really important thing to understand is you use the word fast track. Mm-hmm. I hate the fact
I didn't use the word fast track. People are saying it was fast track.
I hate the fact that somebody coined the term fast track for these vaccine development, because everybody in their head equates fast track with shortcut. And that's just false. Mm-hmm. These vaccines underwent the exact same testing of every single vaccine goes through. Same number of people, same number of trials, same number of safety standards, same everything. The fast tracking occurred outside of the trials. It's when we did the regulatory review of paperwork, the approval of paperwork and how fast people work through it. And most importantly, manufacturing. The large pharma companies built manufacturing plants and pre-made the vaccine before the trials were done. Mm-hmm. This is unheard of. If you're a large-scale corporation developing a drug, you do not build a manufacturing plant and make millions of doses until you know it works. Because if it fails, guess what you do? You lose an enormous amount of money. This time we changed the game. And so that's why it was fast-tracked. But no safety shortcuts were taken whatsoever. The other thing that people have to understand is we didn't start from zero. So most of the vaccines that we currently are working on or that are licensed or coming out are actually based on SARS vaccines. So what happened in the SARS outbreak was we had hundreds of people working on vaccines and they developed vaccines. But by the time they developed them, the outbreak was over. And so they never got to test them. Now, since SARS-CoV-2, the COVID virus is very closely related to the SARS virus, SARS-CoV, what we just did is we did a plug and play. We took out the SARS piece, put in the new virus piece, but the car was the same. We just kind of put new leather interiors inside it. And it's pretty much the same car. So that's how we saved a ton of time. And the good news is we'd already played with that technology for over a decade. So we knew a ton about it when it was time to work on this vaccine.
What do we know right now about the impact of the vaccines on fertility?
We know nothing about the impact of the vaccine on fertility because we haven't given the vaccine to people long enough to measure their fertility. It's only been around for a few months. However, there is absolutely no scientific basis that I can come up with to wonder why this would have any effect on fertility. And let me just remind people of the fundamental facts here. If you get infection with COVID-19, you are infected with 100% of the virus, which will reproduce in your body. Every single person, whether you're young or old, you get 100% of the virus. If, on the other hand, you get, let's say, the Pfizer vaccine, we will give you 2% of the RNA of that virus. Not even all the rest of the stuff, the proteins and everything else that make up the virus, just the actual genetic code, we're going to give you 2% instead of 100%, and that 2% can't reproduce in your body. 2% non-reproducing versus 100% that reproduces billions of times in your body, I'll take the 2%, thank you. That's going to be much safer.
Healthcare workers are going to be among the first to be eligible to receive the vaccine. What role do you think that they're going to play in the battle against COVID?
We have a responsibility to take care of our patients. This is why we do what we do. And that responsibility means we have to lead. We have to lead in education. We have to lead in removing misinformation from the system. We have to be honest and transparent about what we know and what we don't know. And we have to take on the fact that if there is a minuscule risk of some new vaccine that we don't know the 20-year long-term side effects, that that's a risk we have to be willing to take because we chose to be caregivers. We're working in that environment. We have that responsibility to our patients.
Where do you think we should be focusing our efforts right now?
Right now, I actually think the important thing is to be concentrating on getting our vulnerable population vaccinated and the people that care for that vulnerable population. If we can actually put up a wall around the vulnerable populations, an immune wall due to the vaccine around that population, then hospitalization rates will drop, death rates will drop. And that returns to us as care providers, as healthcare individuals, that we need to get ourselves vaccinated so that we don't feel responsible for having transmitted the virus.
Okay, thank you so much for this. Thanks for your time.